and Sid in the morning.
You betcha.
You should know there is no plan B.
That challenge is one that we're willing to accept.
Talk Radio 77
WABC.
The Orioles have the tying run at third now. The lead run at first with one away. Straight away for him in the outfield. And there's a drive to right center. Swoboda comes up with it. The tag at third. Here comes Frank Robinson. The game is tied. Ron Swoboda making another sensational catch for the Mets.
J.C. Martin comes up here now. Runners at first and second. Nobody out. He squares to bunt. Bunts the ball. A good one. It's taken now by Rickett. Throws to first. Out and hit him in the back. Here comes the winning run. The ball is in play. The Mets win the ball game.
My fingers bled. Was it summer of 69?
Yes, a very, very historic summer of 69. And we do have greatness in the studio, as I mentioned, Ron Swoboda. But I just want to wish a happy birthday to my beautiful daughter, Melanie. My beautiful girl, my little girl. She turns 24 today. She's on her way to work. She works for ARC Excess, a surplus insurance company. And they've been great to her. Chris Cavallaro, one of the bosses, fantastic. 30 years in business. But I love you, Melanie. You're beautiful. You're a beautiful inside and out, just like your mom's. And I love you.
Happy birthday to Melanie, 24 years old. And what's ironic about that is, as you wish your daughter a happy birthday, sitting to my left and your right is the great Ron Swoboda, who just yesterday,
really?
Celebrated his 75th birthday. Happy birthday,
Rock on,
Ronnie.
Rock on. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, it's been good. I was thrilled. The Citi Field, seeing happy birthday. Like, can it be any better?
Well, you just have to be happy they got your name right. They spelled it right. And they didn't have you as dead when you're still alive.
Yeah.
Well, you know, some of us are not here from that 69 team. And we kid, but, you know, it's like mortality starts sneaking up on you. And you don't have the call there. But
no, you don't.
But it's cool. And you know, I said something about that 69 team. Fred Shearer's wonderful line about, he wrote on the board before Game 7 for the Stanley
for
Cup
the
with the Flyers, Philadelphia Flyers, win this one tonight, boys, and we walk together forever. And you know, whether we're on this planet or not, that 69 team walks together forever.
Beautiful. Oh, there's no doubt. And, you know, the whole story about that whole team, and, of course, your early days with the Mets and the whole number thing with Kenny Boyer, that was great stuff. Eventually, you end up with number 4. But that whole season, coming all the way back, as you guys did, left for dead behind the Cubs in August. I mean, as miraculous as the playoff run was, the August-September run, one of the greats of all time.
You know, I remember in August where we're playing good. We've run off a bunch of strings. We got Don Clendenin in the middle of June. We got all the pieces in place, Seaver and Kuzman and Gentry, and all those guys are... They're pitching 9 innings and winning games, and we're 10 back of the Cubs, and we're like, are we going to, like, arrive at some degree of respectability and end up as the pumpkin in somebody else's Cinderella story?
Right.
It seemed like, you know, this could happen, you know, and it was like, when are they going to fade? When's something going to happen to them? And it was in August, near the end of August, and that's why we didn't do a lot of scoreboard looking, because we were back 6-10 game.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, the end of August, first week in September, the Cubbies hit the skids, and they hit it big time, and we're winning 3 out of 4, and we blew by them like, you know, on the expressway, somebody changing their tire.
Yeah,
you know
who that?
New Orleans.
Yeah,
I live in New Orleans.
Right, exactly.
Who that say they're going to beat them Mets?
And you did blow right by him. And then, of course, you had the win over Atlanta. And that was great.
Which, by the way, you did not play in.
I had no at-bats. I had a scare. Uh-huh. You know what a scare is? I was on deck warming up to pinch it. That's called a scare.
Were you disillusioned that you didn't play in that?
I was getting rusty because I didn't play in 10 days before the World Series. But you know what? Our left-handed hitters out-hit Henry Aaron and Rico Carty and Orlando Cepeda. And keep this in mind. In spring training, the Braves were trying to trade Joe Torre to the Mets.
Yep.
And they wanted guys like Nolan Ryan, Gary Gentry, maybe Kuzman. You know, I mean, you know, they wanted our good young arms that were going to pitch for us that year. Johnny Murphy does not make that deal. They trade Torre straight up for Orlando Cepeda.
Yep.
And they don't get the pitching they want, the Braves. And we out, and our left-handed platoon out hits them, outscores them in a high scoring, you know, best yeah. three out of five, and we sweep them.
Well, like Bernie yeah. said, you didn't play in that series. But of course, when you go back to the 69 World Series, game four, we played the audio. Brooks yes. Robinson hits this line drive, and it's destined to go to the wall. Two runs are going to score, and you guys are going to lose that game four. And a lot of people to this day still say, including most of your teammates, if that ball gets by you and we lose that
Trouble.
Game, they don't think you're going to win the World Series.
Trouble.
Yeah, so you have been given credit, that one catch in game four, for basically winning the World Series.
Well, yeah, and the advisability of taking the line I took and making the catch, or trying to make the catch, is, you know, even Don Clendenin, who's a lot smarter guy than I was, he was a clubhouse lawyer, right? The only clubhouse lawyer I ever met who was actually going to law school, passed the bar and practiced law when wow. he was finished with baseball.
No
we
kidding.
Loved that guy. He was
yeah.
perfect piece for us in 69. But you know, it would have taken me more time to think about why I shouldn't have gone after that ball than just go.
Right.
And I had taken thousands of line drives, ground balls from Eddie Yost, working on my outfielding because I made a bunch of mistakes out there. Shea's outfield was hard to play because the stands stood tall and there were always people in there. So the background, the ball never came out of the background. The background's mercurial. It's fluid and dependent on the atmospherics. It's a tough background. You got to learn how to deal with that and block that out and read that ball off the bat. And I read it off the bat and I made the best line I could make. And, you know, look, honestly, 95% of the way there, I said, uh-oh, we're in trouble.
Yeah.
But you can't stop. You know, I only ran like 3-4 strides and then laid out.
Yep.
And, you know, everybody says if you don't catch it, it goes to the wall. Well, there's a lot of things that can happen between catching it and going to the wall. I could have knocked it down.
That's possible.
It hits me in the web about 2 inches before it finds grass.
Thank
okay?
the Lord Jesus.
Holy.
Now, listen, so
mackerel.
Ron Swoboda is the guest. The book is Here's the Catch, A Memoir of the Miracle Mets and More. And you joke about this. Somebody asked you this question. How long are you going to keep living off this one catch? And your answer is very funny.
How long have I got? You know, because, well, I said to somebody, a lot of guys had a career. I had a catch, you know, and I meant, you know, there was a sport.
Well, you're being humble. There was a lot of home runs. I mean, you did some big things. And by the way, the game-winning RBI hit in the game where you beat the Baltimore Orioles. So you're being humble.
Well, I think that says more about Gil Hodges, who, in my humble opinion, is should be in the Hall of Fame.
Biggest omission.
It should be a no-brainer.
Biggest omission. Besides and Pete Rose and Barry Bonds.
It makes you question the process. But he's got another year, and that just has to happen. But Hodges would go with hot, you know, and in this age of analytics where they can measure everything and they know exactly who should be here and who should be here, hot skews the percentages in a positive direction and you've got to pay attention to it. And that skews percentages up and down. If you're cold, then you make a move. When I was hot in that game and he let me hit off that sidearm right-hander and I lofted yep. one down the left field line that Don Buford doesn't catch. Just like I missed his ball to start the World right. Series because I just misplayed it. But we end up with the go-ahead run. And well, you know, I'm standing at second base thinking, holy crap, this is the first time it's in our hands now. It is in our hands.
You can win it.
It's ours to lose.
Right.
Whoa.
And you won it. So tell Bernie and I and the listeners about that year. The Jets, they win the Super Bowl that year. The Knickerbockers win the NBA championship.
Yeah.
Man walks on the moon. We've got drunken high kids up at Woodstock yelling and screaming. You guys win the World Series. Tell us what it was like to be in New York in 1969.
Well, yeah, and you mentioned all those things. The identity politics, the riots at the Stonewall Inn, gay awareness.
Yeah, Bernie was there.
Yeah.
I'm telling you.
I had some friends there.
Look.
On the wrong side.
I understand.
No longer friends.
I understand. But they had a point to make and made it. And you had all of that. There was money in the system.
Oh, yeah.
But it was a very fractious time between the Vietnam War and anti-war back then. It seemed like it was a time when everything and anything could happen. And the least predictable would have been us winning 69. And we were tuned into all that stuff. But you live in kind of a bubble as a baseball player. They're driving you to the ballpark and to the airport and back home and stuff. But we were, when Neil Armstrong walked on the moon, we're in Montreal. And we finish up, that's the end of the first half of the season. We're trying to jump, normally we jump on our little United charter and head back to New York. We've got mechanical problems in the airplane. And so we repair to the lounge, and over a couple of pops, that's when we watch Neil Armstrong take his small step for man, giant leap for mankind live on television. It was a heady experience. And I was a big sort of flight, aviation, NASA fan, space travel. I love that stuff. And we, you know, Eddie Krenkel and I are there clinking glasses going, wow, man, is this like an amazing thing that America has done and Armstrong?
On TV, no
The
less.
Irony, though, the irony is we can't get from Montreal to New York and here's this guy putting footprints on the moon,
funny.
You know? And
That's funny. Ron Swoboda, Here Is the Catch is the book. Hey, yeah, so Ron, you had all those wonderful years. I mean, that wonderful year, all those events in that wonderful year. But let me ask you this question. You talked about Woodstock. People were into drugs and stuff like that. And then the 70s came along. But you and the whole team, none of the guys got into that type of lifestyle. You've led a pretty clean life for the most part, despite the temptations, I'm sure, that were out there.
Look, our drug of abuse was alcohol, okay? And most of us... Look, you want honesty? I had a couple of beers after every ball game I ever played. You know, it's like our motto was win or lose, we will drink.
I'd be more impressed if you said I had a couple of beers before.
Only a couple of times when I was not feeling well. But honestly, we probably, of the guys that drank, we drank too much. We abused ourselves. We were athletes, and sometimes it was a way of, you know, if you were celebrating or you were easing the pain, you know? It's like a losing.
Sure, of course.
Alcohol, you knew what it would do.
Steady the nerves.
No, that's good. And, you know, Seaver, of course, he wasn't there. They renamed that way 160.
41 Seaver.
That's pretty cool, right?
I was there. I was there for that.
I know
and that
you
was
were.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
His daughter, Sarah, gave the most wonderful speech, and she was nervous, but it was so genuine, the emotions and stuff. And you're sitting there thinking, this is the most appropriate thing this team could do.
Yeah.
You know.
It was nice. Well, listen, great career. And Bernie, as you know, Ron, also one of the few guys, many guys actually, that played for both the Mets and the Yankees in 1972. Yes. He was a teammate of Thurman Munson and Bobby Mercer and Roy White and Mel Stottlemyre.
Mm-hmm.
So you've
got
it all.
Good guys all. Look, I wore the pinstripes after all the hullabaloo with the Mets in a World Series. And I tell you what, walking out on the field in Yankee Stadium the first time, this is old Yankee Stadium, with my little NY on my shirt and the pinstripes, the little hairs on my neck stood up.
Wow.
Sure.
Wow.
But, you know, and here's a trivia for you. Who's the last guy to play center field in old Yankee Stadium?
Ron Swoboda.
You're looking at him.
Wow, look at that. Look at that. We have history in the studio in more ways than one.
We'll wrap it up with that. The book is, again, Here's the Catch. Ron Swoboda, Met Miracle Outfielder, Hero, Super Guy. But happy birthday. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you guys for having me.
A pleasure.
The great Ron Swoboda. We'll come back with the Shrewsbury Blitz right after this.
Bernie and Sid in the morning. Talk Radio 77 WABC.
Hey, it's Brian Kilmeade.
Brian Kilmeade, host of Fox News Radio.
Join me every weekday morning at 10, right after Bernie and Sid in the morning on 77 WABC.